morning. It really is a pleasure and actually quite exciting to see all of you here. I have been engaged in the discussion and debate, and actually with many of you, I've seen a lot of friends out in the audience. It is a great pleasure to see finally this beginning to come to some fruition. And to hear someone like Steve Specker, who's a good friend and a leader of EPRI, talk about the kind of transitions that are now inevitable. The world has changed, and it's changed a great deal in the last few years. And as Steve mentioned, $140 a barrel of oil concentrates the mind. And I'll talk about that a little bit, or at least concentrates the pocketbook. What I want to talk about is basically two points. One, why I think this is probably even more urgent than we have thought about so far, and how massive the challenge actually is that we have in front of us. This is not a small undertaking. This is a very large undertaking. Steve talked about it in terms of decades, and I think that's exactly right. Unfortunately, the climate is waiting around decades. It has begun to change, and that's the problem that we face today. That essentially, what we've got is an enormous system with an enormous amount of momentum. My background is, I'm literally a rocket scientist. I'm an astronautical engineer. I worked on Apollo many years ago. Fluid mechanics is my background. I did my first climate assessment in 1977 when I was at Stanford Research Institute, and the question was global cooling, because the world had cooled from 1960 to 75, and ERDA, the predecessor of DOE, was interested in the question of whether we needed vastly more energy because the world was going to get colder. Well, just as we were doing our study, the world turned again and started warming. And I think the point is very simply that this is not a new issue. And in fact, there's a wonderful little clip if you go to YouTube, type in Unchained Goddess, and you will see a Bell Science Series program from 1958. Which I saw as a kid, on climate change caused by burning too much coal and CO2, and how we would one day be watching the sunken towers of Miami from glass-bottomed boats. 1958, we began to talk about this. It was part of the dialogue in the 70s, the 80s. We began to get somewhat serious in the 1990s, but all the while, the momentum and mass of this climate has been moving. And we haven't done anything about it. We've done essentially nothing. And as a result, climate change is going to continue, and it's going to get worse. We've seen three events in the last few years that give us some hint of what the future is like. We saw it most recently in Myanmar, in the cyclone, where millions of people died. We've seen it in the rice market worldwide, driven in part by the six-year drought in Australia. We've seen mega storms hit Bangladesh. What we've got is, in fact, a climate that is already beginning to change. This is not a distant future problem, and therefore the urgency of what we have is profound. I do share Al Gore's view that this is, in fact, a crisis for our civilization. I don't actually share his views on policy altogether, but I do share his views on the sense of urgency and the fact that we have not yet done enough about it. First of all, the world is going to get rich. It is rich, and it's going to get richer. Today, we've got somewhere on the order of 1 to 2 billion people who are fairly well off. And the next 20 to 30 to 40 years, the time that Steve was talking about, we're going to add another 3-4 billion people driving cars, having homes, taking vacations, doing all the things that all of us enjoy doing. And they're going to want more stuff. And even in the more subsistence societies in part of the poorer parts of China, India, Africa, Latin America, even there the energy demand is going up, particularly because we need water and food. And the production of water and food in those parts of the world are becoming ever more energy intensive. Moving water around takes a great deal of electricity. In this state, 20% of our electricity goes to moving water. So water and food and electricity are intimately connected issues. So the economic reality is that we are going to need vastly more energy. And in part, you can see it here in the numbers. This is what's happened over the last 30 years with respect to wealth, the world's gotten 3.5 times richer, and on a per capita basis, twice as rich. And that's going to keep on going. And we cannot deny the world's poor the right to have a decent standard of living. We can't close the door now that we are all well off and say, well, okay, game over. We had it, you don't. Not going to happen. They're going to do it one way or the other. And that's the issue that we face. Now, when you start thinking about the world, several things matter. Size matters. China, India, United States, these are countries that matter enormously. I work very closely with the government of Singapore. They don't matter. They can be interesting in terms of technology, but they don't matter. History matters. How we've consumed energy, coal in the United States, in Europe, and so on, natural gas and oil in Russia. History matters in terms of what kinds of energy we use, and density matters. Obviously, in terms of population density, transit is very much an issue. In the United States, we opted to spread our population all over the landscape. It's called the Interstate Highway Program and the FHA Home Loan Program, and we spread ourselves all over the place. We didn't put ourselves in dense cities like the Europeans and the Asians have done. So as a result, mass transit is difficult. Hence, we have to focus on electric cars. So our history matters, our size matters, and density of population matters. So if you just look around the world, this is what's happening today in terms of population, but this is where the world is going to be in the future. And even here in the United States, we're continuing to grow. We're the only rich country that is growing rapidly, but Africa, India, China, and the rest of Asia are going to add somewhere on the order of another 2 to 3 billion consumers of energy, and who are going to be producing enormous environmental impact. So this is, the landscape that we have to deal with. And the cultural reality is that people want a higher standard of living. They do. They want all the stuff we want. When I was at Stanford Research Institute and we were doing those studies, my colleague Dwayne Elgin and I and my friend Stuart Brand published an article called Voluntary Simplicity, that we were all going to live simpler, we were all going to reduce our consumption. Well, it didn't turn out that way, right? That isn't what we did. We bought bigger houses. We thought as people got older, why kids leave home? They get a small house. Not true. Now they need a house for all the grandchildren. And so, in fact, and how many of your kids have come home? So the point is that we have not done anything to simplify our standard of living. And even when we make huge gains in efficiency, we often take it as amenity. Not all hybrids are created equal. My wife, I live in Berkeley, and it's mandatory that you have a clean car. And in the carpool, you just can't, driving to school, it's just embarrassing to show up without a hybrid. But of course, my wife is a gardener, and small cars don't appeal to her, and she'd liked having her SUV before, so of course, what did she do? She got a Lexus hybrid, and a big hybrid, which gets about the same mileage as her non-hybrid before. Yeah, about a 10% gain in mileage. We've taken most of our improvement in efficiency, most of our improvement in gains over the last 20 years in a higher standard of living. It's the American way of life.